everyone, and welcome. My name is Michelle Sardone. I'm the Deputy Director at CLINIC, which is the Catholic Legal Immigration Network. And you are joining us today for the workshop Addressing the Legal Obstacles to Immigrant Integration, Protection, and Defense. I'm joined by three really great panelists that I'm excited to hear from. First, we have Father Filippo Ferraro, who is the Executive Director at the Scalabrini Institute for Human Mobility in Africa, and he's joining us from South Africa. Hi there. Also joining us is Rudy Monterrosa, who is a law professor at the University of Notre Dame Law School, joining us from South Bend, Indiana. Hi, Rudy.
Hello, excited to be here.
And then we also have Padre Mauro Verzeletti, who's the director of the Casa del Migrante de Guatemala, and he is joining us from Guatemala. Hello, Padre Mauro. I know he'll have his camera on and his mute off in a little bit. So during today's panel, we're gonna be talking a little bit about the challenges that each person is seeing in their work, the obstacles, the legal obstacles that they're seeing in their communities. And then we're going to talk a little bit about the things that have both worked and haven't worked in their ministry and in their work on the ground. We'll end by going through some common themes and some questions from you in the audience. And then each speaker will have a short call to action at the end of our presentation. So just to start us off, I wanted to talk a little bit from my experience at CLINIC. So we are a national network of over 380 affiliates all over the United States. And so we are definitely seeing legal obstacles in our communities every day, whether it be proposed regulations that are limiting access to asylum or eliminating fee waivers or public charge, you know, the elimination of humanitarian programs or at least the proposed elimination of things like DACA and temporary protected status, and border policies that are keeping thousands of people waiting in Mexico when they have come to seek protection from the United States. So that is really what we're seeing all over the US, but we're gonna dig a little deeper from each of our three panelists. So Father Filippo, I wanna start with you. What, in your work, what obstacles are you seeing in your area for those that are seeking protection and seeking legalization, whether they are, the legal obstacles may be legislation or policies or process. Could you talk to us a little bit about those obstacles?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Michelle. So I'm based here in Cape Town, South Africa. Usually when I speak about the situation of refugees, asylum seekers, migrants in South Africa, I have to say before, when we talk about Africa, especially, you know, I'm originally from Europe, we talk about Africa like a country, while Africa is a big continent, and there's a very heterogeneous and wide range of migration all around the continent. And especially in this area, we have a big, very huge migration to South Africa. And it's both made of economic migrants and refugees. And this situation in South Africa is very particular. You know that we have a very short and young story of democracy. So what happened after 1994 is that the new government put in place a very liberal and wide refugee act that allows all the refugees who are coming to the country to be hosted. And they have the right, the freedom of movement and the right of study and working. And this is, a huge policy compared to many other all around the world and also in Africa. But at the same time, there's a very, very strict Immigration Act. so that this is penalizing so much low-skilled workers, for example, that are the majority of migrants probably here in South Africa. You know that South Africa is seen here in the continent, like is USA in the American continent, but also in as every the movement from here is in, from Central Africa, East Africa to South Africa is huge. So there are a series of legal obstacles that migrants and especially refugees are facing here in South Africa. I think that there is the issue, first of all, of an ineffective judiciary, because even if there are good laws, I mean, I was talking about a very liberal and free refugee act, many times both courts and also on the side of administration, these are not implemented. And it's very, very difficult for refugees to see their rights recognized and so this is creating a very difficult situation. I can give a couple of examples so we can enter into the field. We had a very huge problem about, for example, the slow legislation, because the law in South Africa says that if you are arrested, you should appear to judges in 48 hours. But many times refugees, migrants, don't have the possibility to appear to the judge before 30 or 90 days. And obviously this is compromising their rights. And this is a huge problem. So we had, especially with other pro bono organization of lawyers work for this to allow them to have this right recognized. Another big issue is that the government decided to limit and close some of the refugee reception office, that are those offices where the refugees must go to renew their permit. And this creates a very, very big problem, because they were forced to go back to the office where they enter, I mean, to the borders. And we are talking about a long trip, an expensive trip, and with the risk of losing their job and having a lot of consequences. So also here we had a strong work of advocacy that we put in place. We are a study center, so we make research to support our advocacy team in our sister organization, that is the Scalabrini Center of Cape Town, where we have a strong advocacy team. And so we were able to win the litigation with the government. But also here, the issue is that we won the litigation, but that it's still there, the situation, because the government is taking time, and before they say we don't have the budget to reopen the reception office now. And so these are some of the legal obstacles that we are facing. So sometimes it's about laws and regulation, but many times it's more about the implementation of this regulation. And obviously the big issue is when I think about administration, the officer that is sitting in the office in Home Affairs and receives the request of a refugee can make his life harder more than a bad regulation or an unjust law. And that's a big thing.
Thank you, Father. So Rudy, moving back over here to South Bend, there are some things that Father just mentioned that I think may sound ring true to you as well. Hearing that 30 to 90 days actually seems pretty quick to me, and talking about like the implementation and things being left up to officers. Could you talk a little bit about your challenges here in the US and if there are any similarities to what Father Filippo was saying?
Absolutely. Michelle, one of the exciting reasons why I love being on this panel is because of the fact that I think this exemplifies how we're all human. And so that we're talking about what conditions do people go through such that they would seek to leave their country, to leave their home country, to find protection, or to seek a better life somewhere else. And so I think that that's an issue that's a global phenomenon, not something just here in the United States. And so that's the beauty of being able to actually engage in a conversation with people from around the world so that we can find our similarities within ourselves and what makes us human. I would share with you, Michelle, that my first exposure to the challenges of immigration and asylum come from firsthand experience. I'm the proud son of immigrant parents. My father fled El Salvador seeking protection here in the United States. And my mother came to this country to join my grandfather, who was a migrant farm worker. So she was searching for a better life. So my immigrant history reveals the very issue posed by your question and the reason why I've dedicated my career to helping people like my parents. And I think that the first obstacle or the first issue that we have with people that are seeking protection or legalization is this confusion or this mixing of people that are seeking protection and people that are seeking to be able to remain in whatever country that they seek. So we're talking about asylums as opposed to immigrants. And lately, here in the United States, this administration has been doing a very good job of confusing the two, such that now we're seeing, whereas before it was this anti-immigrant rhetoric that we'd see throughout the country, and quite frankly, something that we're seeing globally, we also see that with regard to asylees and refugees. And so now when people, they're starting to equate this rhetoric against why we didn't want immigrants to be here unlawfully in the United States, and they're equating those same arguments against asylees or refugees. So I believe that's the first issue that we've seen with regard to those two groups of people that may seek to come to the United States. The other, if I'm talking specifically about immigration, and Michelle, you've seen this in the work that you've done, is that first of all, in the United States, we have a very serious visa backlog. So people keep talking about 12 million or 14 million individuals that are here in the United States unlawfully. And what they fail to recognize is a lot of them do have these, do have immigration paperwork filed, but they have to wait 12, 13, 20 years in order to be able to legalize their status. And in the meantime, they're in the United States unlawfully and are equated the same as somebody who may have just come from the United States in whatever status that they came, but we fail to recognize that we have this very serious visa backlog here in the United States and that causes issues for our clients. The other is that we're starting to see an increased prosecution of illegal reentry. And so nowadays we're starting to see in federal court that individuals are being criminalized for what could have been humanitarian reasons for which they came here to the United States. And the other issue I would raise is what you just mentioned right now, Michelle, was that more recently we're starting to see this issue of the public charge, which has been litigated in our courts. Quite frankly, I believe it's an attack on immigrants that are low income or in most dire need. And that has been an issue with regard to immigration. With regard to asylum and immigration, I believe it goes to what Father Filippo was talking about, that I believe there's a lack of knowledge, right? Who can we trust? Here in the United States, and I know our colleague from Guatemala would be able to know about this, that in South America or even in Mexico, we have individuals that are known as notarios. And throughout the country, these individuals who will advertise that they're notarios, when in fact, here in the United States, the only power that they have is to verify that you are who you are who's signing a document, as opposed to in South America or in Mexico, where notarios are known as super lawyers. And that's not the case here. The last one I would say is this fact of not knowing that although you have a right to have an attorney here in the United States, you do not have a right to have them appointed. And so we've seen that there's been a huge difference with the success that people have with regard to their asylum claims or with regard to their immigration paperwork if they're represented. And sometimes not knowing that you have the right to have an attorney can have an impact with regard to your ability to legalize here in the United States. So I believe that those are the main issues that I've seen, certainly since the beginning of my career, but I think now recently it's become more acute as we started to see this anti-immigrant, anti-asylum rhetoric increase in our country.
Thanks, Rudy. Padre Mauro, so let's hear a little bit about the challenges that you are seeing in your community. So we've heard a little bit about, you know, what Father Filippo is seeing about like the implementation of laws being challenges, and things like that. Rudy just talked a little bit about, you know, backlogs and lack of knowledge and taking advantage of individuals. What are some of the obstacles that you're seeing in your community?
Un saludo a todos, un saludo Padre Filippo, ¿no? Compañero de congregación, ¿no? También a Michelle, a Rudy también, ¿no? Conozco bien también El Salvador, trabajo en los dos países, llevando adelante ese trabajo con la población migrante y solicitante de protección. Yo creo que tenemos una historia en la región centroamericana que realmente ha sido muy dura. Por ejemplo, los acuerdos de paz que empieza ahí por los años 90, Guatemala, el último país que sale de la guerra civil interna, ¿no? El Salvador 92, ¿no? Con el asesinato de Oscar Romero, ¿no? Que es una historia que está ahí todavía, una deuda pendiente con la población, ¿no? En El Salvador, Honduras, que fue cooptada por las estructuras del narcotráfico, del crimen organizado, toda una geopolítica armamentística, ¿no? Y justamente los acuerdos de paz era para construir una sociedad, ¿no? Diferente, alternativa, donde las políticas iban a ser más sociales, de bienestar para la población. Sin embargo, luego que se inicia la paz, se ha iniciado el sistema de mercado neoliberal, las privatizaciones, donde que esto ha generado una situación muy compleja, que el 60% de la población centroamericana, sacando en Costa Rica y Panamá, vive de la economía informal y justamente a partir de ahí se empieza, primero con los acuerdos, antes de los acuerdos de paz, teníamos a la gente que salía buscando refugio afuera de los países de Centroamérica. A partir de los acuerdos de paz, la gente sale para migrar, migran para buscar oportunidades de vida más allá de las fronteras en México, en Estados Unidos, en Europa, ¿no? Entonces, ese sistema de mercado ha generado más economía informal. Y la economía informal prácticamente golpea a la clase trabajadora, a los más pobres, ¿no? Entonces, debido a la situación socioeconómica y política que se enfrenta, la gente busca la salida. Entonces, ¿qué ocurre a partir del momento que se empiezan los flujos migratorios en el nuevo milenio? Tenemos el incremento del coyotaje o de las estructuras criminales, del narcotráfico, del crimen organizado, que hoy están captando la ruta migratoria y están teniendo grandes sumas de dinero hoy, saliendo de Centroamérica para llegar a Estados Unidos, está cerca de $10,000, ¿no? Cada persona para llegar ahí. Entonces, es un negocio redondo de esas estructuras criminales. Luego de ahí, termina la guerra, empiezan las narcomaras. Yo llamo narcomaras porque son el brazo derecho de las maras. Y ahí las maras que cobran peajes, extorsiones. Por ejemplo, El Salvador tiene más de $300 millones en concepto de las estructuras de narco, de las maras, ¿no? De las extorsiones que supuestamente dan seguridad. Guatemala tiene 280 millones de dólares al año, Honduras, 290, prácticamente estamos en los 300 millones de dólares en concepto de extorsiones de los más pobres. Entonces, ¿cuál es la política? Extorsionar mucha gente para tener más dinero, porque no van a extorsionar a un empresario, un capitalista, ¿no? Van a extorsionar a los pobres, ¿no? Entonces, este es el problema, la deuda que tiene el Estado con los pobres en esos países. Por eso que empieza las migraciones. Tenemos el evento 2014, cuando los niños empiezan a salir, niños no acompañados, a los niños, niñas y adolescentes que salen, ¿no? Que salen, que van a buscar la reunificación familiar, o que los papás quieren sacarlos del reclutamiento de las maras de 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 años, 15 años, ¿no? Los adolescentes, ¿no? Que son las víctimas más fuertes. Luego, ahí toda la situación que se da ahí en la frontera México y Estados Unidos, que ustedes bien conocen, yo no voy a profundizar esa temática, pero todavía hay una deuda que saldar con estos niños, niñas y adolescentes que están enjaulados, ¿no? A partir de 2018, ¿no? Y aquí pongo esto, ¿no? Yo estaba allá en San Salvador, en la Plaza Central, Plaza Barrio, celebrando la canonización de San Romero, ¿no? Y justamente ahí me empiezan a llamar los periodistas, ¿saben que va a salir caravanas de El Salvador y de Guatemala? Pues me empiezan a llamar y ahí yo dije, bueno, hay rumores, pero no sabemos. Yo fui, terminamos de celebrar ahí la misa, yo agarro el carro a la madrugada y vengo para Guatemala, y aquí justamente el 16 llega 6,000 personas en la Casa del Migrante en Guatemala. Entonces, las caravanas que se dan desde 2018 y prácticamente han sido constantes 2018, 2019, enero de 2020 hemos tenido una caravana masiva, y ahora en tiempos de pandemia se estima que ya son 6,000 personas que han cruzado la frontera, ¿no? Entonces, es una situación muy compleja donde que sabemos que las políticas son criminalizadoras, que criminalizan a los migrantes. Cada vez más la frontera se va corriendo hacia el sur. Hoy, por ejemplo, 5,000 militares de la Guardia Mexicana están cuidando la frontera para que no crucen. Ahora el gobierno de México, Manuel López Obrador, dijo que el migrante que cruza la frontera en tiempos de pandemia va a ser sancionado con 7 años de cárcel. Entonces, realmente es una criminalización al derecho a migrar. Yo siempre voy a defender ese derecho, un derecho humano, un derecho fundamental, porque existe el derecho a no migrar. Sin embargo, ese derecho a no migrar no se está abriendo la posibilidad del espacio para que las personas puedan quedarse, que vivan con dignidad y con derechos en su propio país. Hoy la migración se ha globalizado, y cada vez más se ha globalizado como la tecnología y todo eso, ¿no? Y los excluidos, para salvarse, tienen que migrar. Entonces, ese es un gran problema que estamos enfrentando. Ojalá que haya cambios a partir de esta pandemia, ¿no? Porque realmente tenemos ahora, somos tercer país seguro, donde el año pasado fueron deportados 280,000 personas, y Donald Trump, y con el gobierno de Jimmy Morales, otro mafioso también, ¿no? Yo no tengo miedo de decir las cosas, ¿no? Jimmy Morales, donde firmaron tercer país seguro. ¿Dónde? Donde que fueron deportados 110,000 guatemaltecos desde Estados Unidos y México, tercer país seguro. Nosotros hemos atendido ya 900 personas bajo el acuerdo de cooperación de asilo en Guatemala, y sin embargo las personas se quedan en una situación de vulnerabilidad, porque no existe estructura del Estado para atender a los solicitantes de asilo. ahora ya está firmando con Honduras también el acuerdo de tercer país seguro, con El Salvador también. ¿Cómo si la gente sale, no? Sale del matador y los regresan el matador, ¿no? Entonces, es terrible esa situación. Yo creo que África también vive esa situación, ¿no? Donde las personas huyen para salvar la vida. No huyen por otra cosa, no son delincuentes, no son criminales, ¿no? Y toda esa situación que hoy se está generando dentro de la xenofobia, del racismo, hacia las personas que migran. Entonces, es un contexto bastante complejo que estamos viviendo, bastantes desafíos tenemos por delante, ¿no? Y yo aquí tengo que decir gracias a la cooperación internacional. Trabajamos porque la cooperación, después voy a profundizar esto, a la cooperación internacional que realmente es nuestra gran aliada en este contexto.
Thank you, Padre Mauro. So in landing there in kind of international cooperation, I wanted to move into, you know, now that we saw all of these themes around common challenges, right? Where we're seeing the criminalization of migration, where we're seeing immigrant feelings in the community, where we're seeing multiple obstacles, both in legislation and in policies and process. Each of you are doing really good work in your communities. Can you tell us a little bit about what has helped overcome some of these obstacles, both what things have worked and maybe have there been some lessons that you have learned from things that didn't work and now you've changed course. So why don't we start back over with you, Father Filippo, about what things have been working in your community to successfully overcome these challenges?
This is a very nice question. Sometimes I'm afraid we have to share more about the bad results. But it's not true, because I think that sometimes we are overestimating like good practices. We can learn more from the things that didn't work so much at the beginning. Well, I was mentioning before the big work of advocacy that is obviously a specific work that we are doing. We support with the research. We have a very good advocacy department obviously this is not enough, and we see that it's very, very difficult to have influence on legislation. For example, I see that we are always running after a bad decision of governments and administration. Looks like we are slow in taking a little bit more and taking the voice of migrants where decisions are taken. But a very good work has been done at a level of communities, for example. I think all the activities that we have done as personal development and I think that the best skill of refugees and migrants is resilience, and the most we can support these and make them obviously a protagonist and able to not only to be the object of our advocacy, of our work, but to render them really the active subject of this claim of rights is a big it's a big achievement. And I think especially the work that we try to do with women, because a big part of the issues about also the gender. And we were talking about minors. I think we have also here a wonderful child and youth care center where we work a lot with migrants. And women and minor are the most vulnerable subjects. And so all the those activities of education and personal development and qualification that we can give them is probably one of the best work that we have done. And well, beside this, also the work in the communities, also with the locals, changing that negative narrative is so difficult, But we try to do, for example, we have a program, it's called Unite as One. It means that some of, it's a kind of peer education process that we are taking to the high schools here in Cape Town. So we prepare the youth to talk with the other youth about human rights and racism and gender-based violence and all these things, because we think that they must start to take in their hands this kind of activities. Just to give some light about our work.
Thanks. Yeah, that is great. And you're right, resiliency is definitely a gift in the communities that we serve. Before I turn it over to Rudy, I just want to remind all of the participants that we're going to be taking some questions at the end of our conversation. So please feel free to start putting those questions in the chat box, and we'll get to as many of them as we can towards the end. Rudy, so do you want to talk a little bit about what you have found successful, both things that worked and you want to share that they worked, and maybe as well if there are any lessons that you have learned from things that maybe haven't worked so well?
Absolutely. You know, I'm really, again, fascinated when you hear these issues that are being brought up. You know, what Father Mauro was saying is basically what I'm hearing is that we have to recognize the issues that are happening at the ground. A lot of times we think that with a change in the law or a change in policy, that that's going to make an impact with regard to how we can work with our immigrant and asylee population. But sometimes it's just providing resources and recognizing why is it that we have these issues within our countries, and recognizing that if we get to the root of the cause and provide resources, that perhaps in that way we might be able to make a difference. So one of the, I would say locally, within our firm, what we strive to do is that when we work with people, what works is to just tell them straight, you know, to not sugarcoat it, to basically tell them, these are your rights, this is how this case is going to go, and it could go this way or it could go that way, but to be honest. I think that's what's very important, is to be able to be honest with these, with our clients, to be able to share with them, be they an immigrant or an asylee, that this is how the laws work in the United States and this is what we can do, and more importantly, to be able to empower them, to be able to tell them that they have rights and that we're there with them and that they're not alone. So that's locally here in South Bend, but what I would share at a national level, at a statewide level, it's important to be able to find community partners, right? To be able to find organizations that do good work for the community. So the first one I'd like to talk about is the Dilley Pro Bono Project. And the Dilley Pro Bono Project is based down in Dilley, Texas, which is a small town on the southern border of Texas. And, you know, I hear Father Filippo talk about our women and our children. And a lot of times when we're here in the United States, we like to think that we don't have atrocities or we don't have these human rights violations that are occurring against anybody that comes to the United States. And the reality is that is not the case. When we went down to Dilley, we took some Notre Dame law students so that they would be able to volunteer and see what it's like to be able to work given this experience that you have with regard to immigration and asylum law, to be able to give back to the community. So we went down to Dilley. You started hearing these stories from women and children that were detained, that were coming from Guatemala, El Salvador, Honduras. Lately, we've even been seeing women coming from Romania, from China. But the bottom line is then we hear about what they went through when they came into the United States. And one of the first things they go through is they put them in what they call la hielera, an icebox. So then these women and children are placed in ice boxes, literally big holding cells that are set to these really low temperatures in the hopes that they would give up, that these women and children would say, you know what, this is too terrible, just go, I voluntarily decided to go back. But let's recall that these are women and children that are seeking asylum, they're seeking protection. What Father Mauro was talking about with the narcomaras and the issues that were happening in the Central American region, that this is not as bad as whatever is occurring back home. And then from the ice boxes, they transfer them to the las perreras, the dog cages. So where they're literally in cages, women and children in cages. And of course, then we also heard about the separation of women and children and parents from their children, which was a policy that this government had implemented. Again, with this idea that if we start doing this, that perhaps people will decide that it's better to stay in their country and face whatever it is that they're facing in their country rather than to go through this. And then once they come and if they survive all that, once they get here into another detention center, then they have the opportunity to present their claim. And that's what the Dili Pro Bono Project does. They empower women. They tell them this is what your rights are with regard to being able to file for an asylum claim here in the United States. They encourage students and law students, college students, lawyers from throughout the country to come down to Dili, Texas, and to be able to provide services pro bono. And so, as like I mentioned before, you do not have a right, you have a right to an attorney, but you do not have a right to have one appointed to you. So it's up to us, for those of us that are blessed to be attorneys, or for those of us who are blessed to be bilingual, to step up to the plate and then be able to provide these services to those that are greatest in need. So the Dili Pro Bono Project is one example of how the community here in the United States is standing up and doing something for people that come into the United States. I would share with you here locally in South Bend, Indiana, I might have mentioned that I'm a school board member, and our school board here in South Bend has a bilingual services department. And within the bilingual service department, we have the Migrant Regional Service Center, where we collaborate with the Indiana Department of Education to identify and serve 100% of the migrant students that we have within our corporation. So a lot of times we talk about the adults that came here to the United States, and sometimes we forget to talk about, well, except for the fact that we're hearing about them being detained in ice boxes and cages, but we forget that sometimes these children in one way or another are in our system and we have to provide services to them. So here in South Bend, what we're doing is that through the Migrant Regional Service Center, we help migrant children overcome this education disruption. We identify various health-related problems, and we identify these academic obstacles in the hopes that they would still graduate from high school and go on to college or make something or be able to be fruitful with their lives. So that's one way that we're able to do something locally. The other example is something nationally. So what I found has worked is being able to work with community partners. Yesterday, we heard from Sam Centellas, who's the executive director with La Casa de Amistad. They serve here as a community center to be able to provide resources, and more importantly, to just be able to provide information to people, because there's a variety of issues that come up. You know, I'm having issues with my rent right now in the age of COVID-19. I'm having issues with being able to eat. I'm having issues to be able to provide internet access to my children because we don't have good Wi-Fi at home. So it's up to our community members, or one example that you may have heard of, the South Bend School Corporation decided to put buses in the areas with Wi-Fi so they could provide this access to children so that they would still be a part of e-learning. So the question, there's so much that we can do in order to be able to help our community. And so first I would identify that to be able to volunteer and step up and provide assistance and empowerment to those that are at the border, that are seeking asylum protection, and for those that are already here in the United States, I think it's a matter of not just making sure that they can get access to a lawyer, but I believe it's important that they find the resources and that all of us make ourselves available, much like what Father Filippo had indicated, that program with the high school program. It's fascinating. I would love to do something similar here. But that's, I think it's really about empowering our people, giving them that knowledge, and being able to know that we stand together with them to be able to provide these resources and the knowledge in whatever expert field we may have.
Thanks, Rudy. Yes, lots of similar themes to what Father Filippo was saying as well. So Padre Mauro, now to move to you, what are some of the things that have worked in your community to overcome some of the obstacles that you were talking about earlier, both on the side of those that are seeking to migrate, and then those that you talked about having been returned to Guatemala.
Bueno, muchas gracias. Bueno, la casa del migrante tiene una característica de ayuda humanitaria, pero la más fuerte es de la incidencia. Hacemos una atención psicosocial, una asesoría legal, una ayuda humanitaria directa y atención médica. Entonces, tenemos un equipo de trabajo, cerca de 100 trabajadores y trabajadoras, que hoy operamos en 35 municipios en la franja fronteriza con Guatemala, México, con los sistemas municipales de protección de los niños, niñas, adolescentes, migrantes, deportados. También trabajamos en esta misma línea en El Salvador, monitoreando las fronteras de Centroamérica y también los sistemas comunitarios donde que las comunidades sean las protectoras de los niños, niñas y adolescentes. Entonces, hacemos ese trabajo para generar incidencia en los alcaldes de cada municipio, porque sabemos que aquí los alcaldes muchas veces tienen más poder que el presidente en su comunidad. Entonces, es un trabajo, ¿no? También estamos presentes en la Fuerza Aérea Guatemalteca para los deportados y donde ahí estamos recibiendo con convenios con la PGN, Procuraduría General de la Nación, el Instituto Guatemalteco de Migración para acompañar a los migrantes deportados y también los acompañamos en retorno a las comunidades de origen. Y así con los niños, niñas y adolescentes que son deportados, también hacemos, ayudamos a hacer la reunificación de ellos, porque es muy importante que ellos estén en un hogar y que no sean criminalizados o que no sean, por ejemplo, detenidos. Muchas veces existen instancias que criminalizan a los niños, niñas y adolescentes porque salen, ¿no? Pero no es esta la forma que nosotros estamos abordando. Entonces tenemos varios convenios con relaciones exteriores. Trabajamos en la ruta migratoria, en la protección consular, donde tenemos personal que van a asesorar los cónsules, los trabajadores de los consulados para dar una atención humanitaria a sus connacionales cuando están afuera del país. Entonces es una forma distinta de trabajar, ¿no? Prácticamente la casa te acompaña en tu casa que estamos trabajando en las fronteras, ¿no? Entonces, damos esta atención de una forma diferenciada y estamos monitoreando constantemente a la situación de los derechos humanos de las personas. Entonces, por eso que yo digo, esto gracias a la cooperación internacional, ¿no? Porque nosotros como congregación no tendríamos la capacidad de hacer un trabajo de esa, tenemos la capacidad, pero no tenemos dinero. Y cuando existe la inversión de dinero, que es la cooperación internacional, puedo decir ACNUR, UNICEF, OIM, este Consejo Noruego, CRS, y tanta, Menonitas y otros más, ¿no? Trocaire, que nos apoyan ahí para hacer ese trabajo que estamos haciendo cotidianamente a nivel nacional y a nivel regional, porque también trabajamos en red, ¿no? Y eso es importante, este trabajo en red, porque realmente el trabajo en red hoy es una forma de protección de las personas, la red de casas de migrante, la red de protección de la niñez migrante, que tenemos aliados desde de México hasta Panamá, y en Estados Unidos también tenemos organizaciones que cuando hay problemas legales con los familiares de los migrantes o cuando tenemos que ayudar a que una persona salga de esos países para salvar la vida, Entonces, usamos o tenemos las redes que realmente nos ayuda a hacer esos pasos para que las personas salgan, ¿no? Entonces, todo esto bajo una ayuda directa a las personas. También la protección de personas que están en alto riesgo, ¿no? Hemos atendido personas, por ejemplo, en El Salvador, que no podían poner el pie fuera de la casa, porque las estructuras los iban a matar, ¿no? Tuvimos que, por ejemplo, entrar en comunidades, ¿no? Vestidos de bomberos para sacar personas como muertas para salvarles la vida, ¿no? Entonces, son situaciones que lo hacemos para ayudar a salvar vidas en este contexto que estamos viviendo. Entonces, todo ese trabajo lo hacemos en la base, en los sistemas municipales, en la comunidad, ¿no? Para que se empoderen las personas de sus derechos y que realmente luchen para defender sus derechos como tal.
Thank you, Padre Mauro. I had another question, but I think I'm going to hop into some of the questions that some of the participants have been asking. And Padre Mauro, the first one is actually for you. So talking about, you know, international cooperation, what is the most important thing that advocates in the United States can do to help migrants from Central America, the ones to help support your work? And then Rudy, I'm gonna ask you the same question because seeing those that arrive here in the US, but Padre Mauro, you first, what is it that advocates here in the US can do to help your work?
Bueno, yo creo que esta sinergia bilateral y multilateral es muy importante, porque justamente cuando llega un migrante en Estados Unidos, no llega un número, llega una persona con necesidades, ¿no? Llega una persona que necesita ser protegida, que no necesita ser detenida. Entonces yo creo que, por ejemplo, nosotros estamos trabajando dentro de la estructura de la CRM, Conferencia Regional de Migración, ¿no? Desde República Dominicana hasta Canadá. Entonces, y nosotros estamos conformando como la ROCOM, redes de organizaciones de la sociedad civil para las migraciones, y justamente es un espacio de diálogo todos los años que se hace con los gobiernos de todos esos países para hacer propuestas, ¿no? Por ejemplo, a la propuesta de combate a la trata de personas, el tráfico de personas, de protección de la niñez migrante, de la mujer migrante, de los trabajadores migratorios, ¿no? Yo creo que todo esto está bien amarrado, ¿no? Porque realmente, yo digo, tenemos que trabajar en sinergia desde el origen, tránsito y destino, destino, tránsito y origen. Porque justamente ahí donde que nosotros podemos hacer mayor incidencia para cambiar esas políticas que hoy tenemos que a nivel global que cada vez más criminaliza a los migrantes, ¿no? Entonces, esta cooperación es fundamental, es necesaria. Por ejemplo, yo veo a los migrantes salvadoreños organizando, demandando propuestas políticas de parte del gobierno de El Salvador, las organizaciones de guatemaltecas demandando políticas de parte del gobierno de Guatemala, de Honduras, de la misma forma. Entonces yo creo que esto realmente, si los gobiernos escucharan más este clamor del pueblo migrante organizado, ¿no? Porque también están organizados en su país de origen, ¿no? Sin embargo, muchas veces hay que escuchar más a aquellos que están afuera, porque realmente ellos te ponen sobre la mesa lo que necesita y lo que se necesita para que las personas no tengan que emigrar de una forma forzada, arriesgando la vida, cruzando ríos, veredas, fronteras, en fin, todos esos riesgos, ¿no? Todas esas pérdidas, ¿no? Dice una estadística que prácticamente en ese tiempo de pandemia aquí desaparecieron 200 migrantes en la región, ¿no? Entonces, ¿a dónde están? Pues nadie investiga, nadie sabe, ¿no? Entonces yo creo que hay que tener también un sistema de base de datos, ¿no? Para ver los migrantes desaparecidos, porque toda la semana tenemos llamadas en la casa del migrante para ver si está, pasó por aquí, que anteayer vino la PNC y el Ministerio Público pidiendo si nosotros habíamos atendido personas que están desaparecidas desde Honduras, ¿no? Que desaparecieron durante la pandemia. Entonces, todas esas gestiones se están dando. Entonces, son situaciones muy importantes y yo creo que cuanto más unimos esfuerzos a nivel internacional de cooperación, ¿no? No hablamos de cooperación económica, hablamos de cooperación en líneas programáticas de trabajo para sensibilizar, para ayudar, para proponer, para cambiar, ¿no? Toda esta mentalidad de que se está generando xenofóbica, racista alrededor de los migrantes, que esto se ha acentuado aún más a partir del 11 de septiembre de 2001.
Gracias. Thank you, Father Mauro. Rudy, so taking that example, right, that Padre Mauro was talking about, right, like ministering to people like at the origin, like camino on the way, and at the destination, is there other things that you would add to his response about how advocates here in the U.S. Can help migrants from Central America? Mute.
The famous lines in this global age or this pandemic age. What I was going to say is, first, I wanted to echo what Father Mauro had said, that, and also Father Filippo, that it's a matter of being able to empower our community and be able to inform them so that they know what their rights are. And I believe that those of us who may not be lawyers who are people that care about our fellow man, that's how we can get involved. That's how we can support this community. And so the first thing I would share is that there's agencies, there's organizations nationally, locally, that where you can become a part of them and volunteer and support your fellow man. So here I mentioned before, La Casa de Amistad, we have a food pantry where for those families who don't have food or don't have those access to resources, where you can donate or actually donate food and they would be able to disperse that. In Indiana, we have the Immigrant Welcome Center down in Indianapolis, where they seek to be able to provide resources to those individuals that are here in the United States, be they asylee or immigrants. And so those are organizations that one can get involved with in order to be able to provide support to people that from around the world that are seeking protection or seeking to legalize their status here in the United States. I would recommend two other groups. Clinic would be one, right, Michelle, with your organization, where we can make donations to the work that they're doing and support them. That's right. I see the lovely coffee mug there. The other I would say is the American Immigration Lawyers Association, AILA. They have been very active, have always been. And so that's the Association of Immigration Attorneys. And so they have different pro bono projects, different ways that you can get in the community. So getting involved with AILA, or at least making them aware that you're interested in being able to provide support to people that are here in the United States in whatever status it may be, that's an organization that you can work with. The American Bar Association, I'm a commissioner with the Special Committee on Hispanic Rights and Responsibilities. That organization is seeking to provide throughout the country services to all, not just Hispanics, but be able to provide services to all. And again, empowering our people, letting them know what resources are available. So I think that's one way that we all can get involved. But I believe that perhaps the most important way that we can get involved and that we can support the individuals that are coming here to the United States is to call our legislators, right? To call the people that represent us, to tell them that, hey, these aren't illegals. These aren't people that are taking advantage of our system, that we do not like the word illegal. These are human beings. These are people that we care about. These are our fellow man. And that we want our laws to be changed. You know, we're allowing this anti-immigrant rhetoric to be propagated throughout the country. We're allowing these policies to come into place. Michelle, you mentioned this policy with regard to public charge. it's up to us as a community to be able to stand up and voice our opinion, call our legislators and urge them to change the laws and to make it more humanitarian. And let us go back to what this country was founded on, right? That we were a country where we could accept the poor, where we can accept the downtrodden, that this was a place, a nation of immigrants, right? And we're starting to lose that identity, I believe. I think we're starting to forget that was something that makes this country great. And I believe that if we contact our legislators and be able to encourage them to hear our voice, then I think that's one way that we can support individuals that are here in the United States, either as immigrants or as asylees.
Thanks, Rudy. And even from the administrative advocacy perspective as well, there are so many proposed regulations that people can have their voices heard through that process as well, about submitting comments when something's about to change as well. So moving on to the next question, Father Filippo, I'm going to pose this question to you, but if the other panelists have thoughts about how they might respond in your areas as well, to please chime in. So what in your area, what has the, you were kind of raising some of the obstacles and that you were working on advocacy. What role has the church played in speaking out against some of these issues and these problems in your area?
Well, I'm proud to say that a lot of work has been done from the Catholic Church here in South Africa, especially the South African Bishop Conference, and with the support of many congregation and the Catholic organization, NGOs, Asa Scalabrini, JRS Jesuits, and also other Catholic institutions, as I think about the CPLO, Catholic Parliamentary Liaison Office. We supported some of the big changes that we are asking for legislation and implementation. I was thinking about a big issue that we have here in South Africa, that is the fact that the child born to migrants who don't have regular documents cannot have a birth certificate. And this is affecting obviously the life of the child, because he will not be able to have a normal path in school. He will not access all the health services. He cannot sit and have his matric. Obviously the big issue is that the outcome of this lack of birth certificate will be the statelessness. So we have really a ghost population here in South Africa, and it's a common, unfortunately, a common situation. And we had a lot of advocacy on the subject, and we were able to move a lot. Also, with the government, but also at the level of I think about principals in the schools who start to admit these guys and to be more open, even if obviously that sentiment against migrants is not helping them, because it looks like they're stealing something that they're not supposed to receive, while it's just their right. And as church, we still have a big task concerning a big issue that also Father Mauro was mentioning before, that is corruption. So I think that concerning the moral issue, as Catholic Church, I think we must raise our voice, and in the local communities, but also in every public space, we should have the courage to denounce this, because there are a lot of implication. I mean, we've seen during this time of pandemic, this obviously the closure of the borders, But corruption is feeding a lot of bad practices and is allowing human trafficking and a lot of other issues that are affecting the life of migrants and refugees. So I think that this is a big task that we must keep as Catholic Church, and it's not easy, but because it's a long-term change, obviously, that impact that we are searching for. But if we don't start and we don't find the channels, we will never reach that goal.
Father Mauro. Yeah, sure.
Bueno, muchas gracias. Quisiera agregar algo también importante de lo que dijo el compañero Filippo. Bueno, yo creo que tenemos un Papa que vino a dar una movida en esta iglesia, ¿no? Por ejemplo, el acoger, proteger, promover, integrar, ¿no? Yo trabajé 5 años en la frontera México-Estados Unidos, 22 años que estoy en Centroamérica, ¿no? Pero lastimosamente también tengo que decir que me encontré muchos cohermanos en el sacerdocio que se oponían a los migrantes. Los trataban mal. Y mismo en la frontera, México y Estados Unidos, ¿no? California, ¿no? Arizona, ¿no? Decían, ¿por qué vienen aquí esta gente, ¿no? A estorbar, a ocupar el lugar de los norteamericanos, ¿no? Y yo creo que nosotros no podemos ponernos fronteras en nosotros mismos, ¿no? Nosotros estamos aquí entregando nuestra vida por una causa, defendiendo una causa, luchando por una causa, ¿no? Y justamente yo siempre cuando digo, ¿no? Las fronteras fueron puestas por el capitalismo, ¿no? Por los trabajadores, ¿no? Y los trabajadores están al servicio del capitalismo, ¿no? Y el capitalismo solamente ve los trabajadores para su interés, ¿no? Y principalmente los migratorios, ¿no? Porque prácticamente vea cómo los trabajadores migrantes son tan importantes en este mundo. Trabajan y generan desarrollo en el país de destino. Trabajan y generan desarrollo en el país de origen, también de donde salen. Y esto realmente tenemos que valorar, ¿no? Valorarlo profundamente. Gracias a Dios, como digo, que el Papa Francisco vino a mover un poco las conciencias de las personas, de nosotros como iglesia, sacerdotes, laicos y laicas también, porque creo que estaba adormecida esa conciencia y necesitaba ser despertada, ¿no? De su sueño ahí, tranquilo, ¿no? De bienestar, ¿no? Entonces yo creo que es nuestra misión buscar siempre el bien común como iglesia, y me alegro mucho que muchos obispos se han movido también, ¿no? Con esas llamadas de atención del Papa, ¿no? Y pidiendo que realmente la iglesia trabaje con los más pobres, con los más vulnerables, con esas personas que son olvidadas por el sistema.
Thank you, Padre Mauro. So the next question is to all three panelists. It is asking about your perspective on the connection between human trafficking and the importance of how governments respond to the dangers both of those who are vulnerable, you know, waiting for status, and those that may have been deported that are leaving them vulnerable to face human trafficking when they're returned as well. So do any of the panelists want to respond to what they think the connection between kind of human trafficking and maybe government's role to play or response to trying to protect the most vulnerable?
I can answer. Much of the work that we do is in immigration court. So we deal a lot with the fact that people are caught for whatever reason being here in the United States unlawfully, and then they're at risk of being removed. And so to the second part of that question is, what role can the government play as far as recognizing that if we remove people from the United States back to their country, that without due process, then what's the fear that what Father Mauro was talking about before, that we're taking them out from the matador and then putting them back in there? And that was the whole reason why they came here in the first place. So I believe that we need to recognize that those issues exist. One of the frightening things that's happening within our country right now is the expansion of expedited removal, where if we find somebody that's in the United States that's unlawfully present and it's been less than 2 years, that the United States can remove them outside of this country without getting them in front of a judge. And so that's something that's frightening when we talk about due process and when we talk about what are we doing about sending people back. The issue with regard to human trafficking and immigration, one good thing is that we do have a T visa, right? We do have a visa here that specifically deals with people that are victims of trafficking. And we have seen an increase in federal prosecutions with regard to those individuals that are involved with that. So on the one hand, if they can identify that somebody has been a victim of human trafficking, we do have laws that protect those individuals, and the federal government does work towards prosecuting those individuals. But on the other hand, depending on what situation you find yourself in, and if you don't have the know-how or the knowledge to know that you have these rights that are available to you, then you may be subject to being removed from the United States without having an opportunity to see a judge. I'm talking about people that have been here less than 2 years. For people that have been here longer, if you have the wherewithal to say, I'm afraid to go back to my country, you will have the opportunity to be heard in front of a judge. But if you don't know that you can find protection, even if you've already been deported before, even if you may not have any other relatives that are here in the United States, that are in the United States lawfully, if you're afraid to go back to the United States, we're part of a convention, a global convention that recognizes that we're not going to place people back in their country if they're going to be subject to torture or if they're going to be subject to persecution. But I believe that the issue then becomes, are they aware of these rights that they have, and how is it that we inform the community to make sure that they're aware of those issues? And again, that issue that I mentioned before about contacting our legislators to let them know that these laws exist and we want more protection for individuals that are here in this situation, I think that's another responsibility that we need to take for those of us that are here within the United States.
Yes, if I can also add just something. We are also very interested in the phenomenon. A study center, it's, I say, funny because we all know that it is so huge, but we don't have data, and it's so difficult to have the big picture of what is happening. Even if, for example, we had few months ago, some interesting also workshop with police and all those who are investigating in this field, but it looks like they are afraid about human trafficking because it's a crime. So obviously, the government is trying to face the issue, but not from the perspective of helping the single migrant with traffic. I mean, that looks like that's not so important. And the other thing is this working in the field with other groups and associations. We are working with victims of human trafficking, is that many times this is, there's a lot of fear, and they don't denounce this thing. So many victims are twice victims because because they are afraid of being deported, because they don't know how to deal with, because they think that starting this process will be worse than what they are living. So this is, they look like really some of the most vulnerable category in migration. And it's not easy to assist them.
Michelle, can I add to that?
Sure.
Father Filippo, when I hear you say that, we're dealing with the very same issue here. And that's what the problem is with this anti-immigrant rhetoric that we see throughout the country, that we see in the news, that a person can be a victim of a crime or of trafficking, and they're afraid, even though they have this right, even though what I just shared right now, they have this protection, but you're seeing on the news, and nowadays, I think Father Mauro had talked about earlier, nowadays, everything's readily available, right? We see it on the internet, we see it on Facebook, we're sending out Snapchat, and our clients are, you know, our individuals that are here everywhere, I guess everybody has a mobile phone. So they're starting to see all this news and how, oh my gosh, somebody was deported and they had a child, or they've been here in the United States 15 years and they were still removed. And people see that and they don't want to risk it, right? They're saying like, I'm more comfortable being here in the United States. I'd rather not risk it, even if I may have this opportunity to be protected, that this person could be prosecuted so that it doesn't happen to somebody else. But when you see this in the news and you're seeing that people are still being removed from the United States, despite whatever their situation would be, people are afraid, just like what you had said, Father Filippo. It's happening here in the United States, and I'm sad to hear that it also happens there in South Africa.
Thanks, Rudy. So we're getting close to the end of our time together. So I'm gonna have each of the speakers just sum up. You have one final thought that you want to share with everyone that's with us here today, whether it be one additional piece of information you want to share or a call to action that those listening can maybe partake in. Padre Mauro, why don't you start us off?
Bueno, muchas gracias. Yo diría que tenemos que primeramente empezar a aprender a soñar juntos. Soñar junto con los migrantes y con los pies de los migrantes. Porque ellos son aquellos que están sosteniendo esta economía que tenemos hoy a nivel mundial muy perversa, ¿no? Por ejemplo, el último mes de Guatemala, en agosto, mandaron más de $1,000,000,000 en un mes para ayudar a sus familiares. 800,000 por ahí en Salvador, una gran cantidad de remesas que están enviando los migrantes, ¿no? Ellos están soñando que su propio país sea mejor. Entonces yo creo que tenemos que también hacer incidencia para que los gobernantes vean esto, que no solamente digan, ¿no? Qué bueno que estamos recibiendo remesas, ¿no? Pero ¿qué está haciendo para tus ciudadanos, ¿no? Entonces hay que soñar y no debemos de tener miedo de soñar. Soñar significa luchar. Luchar significa transformar esta realidad conjuntamente para el bien del prójimo, de esta gente que hoy está arriesgando todo para salvar su propia vida. Muchas gracias.
Thank you, Padre Mauro. Father Filippo, what about you? What would be your closing thought for everyone?
Well, on one hand, I think that all this conversation, also what was said yesterday in other panels and in other presentation, I think that the importance of working in network it's fundamental to collect all those human resources, all that knowledge and the skills and whatever is necessary to work together for the protection of the rights of migrants. And the other thing is this, I like to try to make this common effort to understand what's behind that sentiment against migrants. There's a lot of fear, there's a lot of social tensions and injustice that probably we don't know how to manage. And so we need to enter in that dark area, because otherwise it will just a fight, a battle. And you know, in every war, in every battle, you never win. You count your wounds at the end. So I think that our advocacy and all our work for migrants and refugees will also try to understand the reason of that sentiment and that negative narrative that is all around.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Rudy, super quickly, do you have anything last thought?
Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
There we go. Okay. First, I just wanted to thank everybody here. It was so exciting to be able to be together in this virtual world. And again, just finding the common ground with Father Filippo and Father Mauro and you, Michelle, has been incredible. And so I've been really excited to be a part of this panel. I wanted to quote a father, Father Daniel Grudy from the University of Notre Dame. He wrote an article calling Crossing the Divide. And in that article, he said, Catholic social teaching recognizes the right and even the responsibility of a state to control its borders. But it also argues that when a state cannot provide the conditions necessary for human dignity, people have a right to migrate to foreign lands even without proper legal documentation. My call to action for all throughout this world is to recognize your fellow man, your woman, as your brother or sister. Set aside your prejudices and do not forget that Jesus was also a refugee seeking protection. I'd ask that people all around don't believe the myths that are generated throughout the world. Take the time to meet your brother, to meet your sister, and take the time to advocate, and don't be afraid to share their story. We are not illegal aliens. All of us, we are human beings. And for those of us who reside in the United States, the call to action is the same, but there's an additional responsibility. We must stand up, get involved, and vote. More than ever in this election season, I believe that we can have a tremendous impact if we're able to have our voice heard. And finally, I would say that in light of this pandemic, in light of what everybody around this world is going through, I ask that we give ourselves the license to love one another and to look out for our fellow man. Thank you.
Thanks, Rudy. I want to thank the panelists. I want to thank CMS and Notre Dame as the conference organizers and all of the behind the scenes support. And I want to thank all of you for attending this session. I hope that we can all listen to Padre Mauro's words about continuing to dream together. Thanks, everyone. Take care.